pretender. Pretending I'm doing well. My need is such, I pretend too much. I'm lonely.
Ciao.
It's so you. You're the one that's burning me upside down and up. So you. You're the one running hot and cold, then not showing up. It's so.
And you get that one. And you get a booklet all about things that I've done in the past and worked, who I've worked with. And that one.
Oh.
And that one. It's God, we did these albums, me and my band, and I think the first one was 1977, and then 78, 76, 77, 78, and then we did the last one in 1980, but they were released then, and we had that, all that time doing them. I didn't realize that we would have such a good time doing them. The first one, which is the one, the main one, which it's not the main one, but that's the one that was produced by Freddie Mercury and Roy Thomas Baker. So that was the first one. And the others followed with a contract I'd done with Goose Productions, which was Freddie's company. And then it was all they were, the first two were released through EMI Records, which was a distribution deal we did. And the third one was released through Rocket Records, which was of course Elton John and John Reed. And John Reed brokered the whole deal. So mm-hmm. That's very quickly, because you wanted to know how it all came about. So that's how it came about. And I was very lucky to do it, because I asked Freddie if he would produce an album for me. I'd done one album before, and he just said, well, yes, let's do it. So we were lucky and we did it. It's different. I don't think it was easier in the 70s and 80s and 90s. It was a different way of what I found was recording was great fun. It was quite difficult in a way, because I wasn't a recording, you know, like Queen were recording all the time. And of course, every time you record, you learn something more. So I enjoyed the process, because it was very new to me. Nowadays, recording is different. A lot of it's done now on computers, as you know. And selling records, it's become a bit of a joke, because nobody wants to pay for anything in the modern world. So you just they just do this streaming, and the artists, to be very honest, we don't make any money from this very little. You have to be honest, you're very, very famous and do millions of streamings, you don't make any money. It's a joke. Even if you write the songs, it's better if you write the song, I suppose, but no, you don't. All you can do, I like singing. I enjoy singing. I find it sometimes it becomes very difficult, and I don't want to sing. And sometimes I just enjoy it. Strange enough, I don't like hearing my voice. I don't like listening to my voice. But now, as I've got older and I've done records, and not that many records actually, I just get used to making sure roughly I'm in pitch. I sing in pitch. And then I just go along with how I feel. So it's to do with my the feeling that I feel within me. And after that, I hardly listen. It sort of goes.
You had to kill the conversation. You always had the upper hand. God caught in love.
Oh, my giddy aunt. Well, one of my favorite songs, I like a lot of the songs that he wrote, and a lot of the songs that Queen wrote, actually. But one of my favorite ones, and the ones that I've I've been doing, and we might make a recording of it later on this year, is Love of My Life. You know that one? Love of my life, don't leave me. You've broken my heart, and now do you leave me? Love of my life, can't you see? Bring it back, bring it back. Don't take it away from me, because you don't know what it means to me.
Love of my life, don't leave me. You've stolen my heart and now desert me. Love of my life, can't you see? Must be more to life than this. There must be more to life than this. How do we cope in a world without love? Mending all those.
Very, very witty, very great. Yes, very. I don't know if I can. I can't tell you this actually. It was. There was one morning years and years and years ago when I was in not Malaga, somewhere like that. Yeah, and they did a concert, Queen, and it was very late at night and everything. And we got back, and the next day when we got to the hotel and things, there were a few of us. And we were drinking all night, really. And the next day, when we were getting on the plane, and we were really tired, Freddie and I were walking there, and whoever was with him, Lee Stone and Crystal, we were walking. And it's just very silly. And somebody rushed up to him and said, oh, how much they liked his concert, and it was a great, how they were great fans. And he just said, fuck off, fuck off, fuck off. We then, because it wasn't meant to be, it was just not the moment for them, you know, people sometimes, but I found it one of the funniest things I've ever heard. I know it sounds very silly. And then we both burst out laughing, because it's just our joke. It was just a joke, you know, and it was, I find that funny, but that's so, it's so juvenile, isn't it? It's like,
for nobody. Time waits for nobody.
It's such a long time now that a lot of things fade into memories. I think what I miss about, or with him, it was the companionship that we had and our sense of humor, like that silly joke I've just told you, which is not really funny, but it's funny to me. The silliness, just being laughing at the most ridiculous things, which nobody else would find funny. And also, he was very supportive of some of the work I was doing. He would come and see plays that I did, or musicals, or shows. And I was able to go and see what the shows that he was doing with Queen. And I was able to go in the studio with them sometimes, if I was here or if I was abroad with them. So it's just it's just things that everybody who have friends, that they just spend time and share memories with. I presume so. So it's just not having that person there. But he hasn't been here for a long time. So it's sort of faded, really, because you make new friends, you know, and you carry on. But what I have is wonderful, fabulous memories, really, and nobody can take that away from me. He inspired me in certain things that I went to see over when Queen were performing and stuff. I liked some of the stuff they did. A lot of it was just our friendship, really, because we didn't have after a certain time. If you were to ask me that now, and was he still alive, then I could tell you. But he died so young, really, that I can just remember some of the things that he did, some of the things he strived for, and some of his ideas. Some I agreed with, some I didn't. But I can't tell you exactly what they are, because it's just, I think that's what just happens. You know, we agree with people sometimes and we don't agree with people.
Love kills, drills you through your heart. Love kills, scars you from the start. It's just...
Yes, was it? I suppose there's a song called Fire Down Below, wasn't it? Gosh, do you know, there were so many things, and so many things I can't tell you, or I don't want to tell, just about people falling into swimming pools and running around. It was just a glorious party. I remember it, fireworks, everything. There's nothing specific, really. A whole lot of his friends, he flew over a lot of his friends from London and America who came to join. And I think we went over, I think eight of us went over in a private plane the day or 2 days before, just to get into the rhythm of a party, just to get in the mood and the rhythm. And it was sensational. It's brilliant. Yes. I can't give you anything specific that I can remember, really. Really good time. And so many of our friends and mutual friends had come in as well, and the band had come in, the Queen. So it was just like a huge family affair, if I dare say that. Yes. Yes. I met Montserrat Caballé with him a few times. I went to see her perform at Covent Garden. She did a couple of recitals. There was one when she didn't turn up. We were waiting, and then she decided she didn't like her hotel, and so she cancelled the concert. And okay. But I mean, that's what opera singers used to do. I don't know if they still do it. I'm not quite sure, because I'm not sure how insurance companies would deal with all of that today. It's a much, but I found her really lovely, and she was such a gentle person, and so she was very gracious to me. I think she's gentle, but she also knew what she wanted and when she wanted and how to do it. So thank she you. Was she was her own person, but I was thrilled to meet her, and she was she was just wonderful. She wrote me a lovely little note on an album, which unfortunately I cannot find, because I lent it to a friend of mine, and I can't remember who I lent it to. So anybody who has it, I didn't lend it to an Italian. It's just somewhere. It's somewhere in England. I'm hoping they'll just give it back to me one day.
Hey, I love you. Yes, I love you.
I haven't spoken to her for about 3 years or something, but not for any reason. It's just, and we will speak to each other one day or not. She's fine, and I mean, I was never not on good. I've always been on good terms with Mary. I've always liked her. We've always been good friends, I think. I hope. No, we had a nice time, and it was lovely to see her. And I met one of her sons, and that. So no, it was lovely. Mary was lovely. But I see Brian and Roger very occasionally, only at social events. We're not like great, you know. We see each other and say hello to each other, and give each other a hug. But I mean, we're not part of a big social scene. Put it that way. Do you know, I've seen over the years many, many Queen concerts. The first big Queen concert I saw, I think, was in, I'm going to get the dates wrong. When they did the big Christmas concert at the Hammersmith Odeon, I think it was. The Beau Rap, when Beau Rap was a big hit, Bohemian Rhapsody. And then I've seen many other concerts in London and around the country. And I went to New York to see some Nedworth. Quite a few. And then I saw Paul Rogers, I think, in Hyde Park, and I enjoyed that. And I saw Adam Lambert about 2 years ago at the O2. But I enjoy them all. Do you know what I really enjoyed about the concerts? And I have to say this. I make no comparison to the singers that we were just talking about as to whether they sing like Freddie or not, because I'm not interested in comparisons. Well, you can't. You can't. How can you compare? We can't. You can't. We can't compare each other. But what I liked was the songs. And I really mean this. It was just great to hear other people sing the songs. And how they stand the test of time, in my opinion. I'm a fan of Queen, so I'm obviously a little bit biased. But apart from that, and I enjoyed the way these gentlemen they sang the songs, and they sang it with the two boys who are perpetuating the Queen and the Queen image and their music, which I think good on them, and I think that's, and I really applaud them for it.
Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality.
I enjoyed the film. I thought it was a good biopic. The depiction was great. I think the actor who played him was very good, and I enjoyed it. Nothing bothered me about it at all. It's just a story. It's a story that goes from A, B, C, D, E about this, a band from the beginning to the end. And it was just done the way it was written. And I find it quite entertaining. In the beginning, because I went to the premiere, and I went with my friend John Reed, who invited me, and with a few other people. And I just found it really entertaining, and we liked it. So yes, yeah.
Oh yes, I'm the great.
Well, the Great Pretender. Very quickly, it's been. I was doing a play at Julius Caesar at Bristol Old Vic, which is out of town in Great Britain in England, and we'd done, before I started rehearsing the play, we had done The Great Pretender as a song on tape, on a vinyl. In my Moran studio, and Roger and I had gone up there and we did the backing vocals, you know. No. So we did that, and then I remember I'd come up from rehearsals and I'd seen Freddie, and we were in the garden at Garden Lodge, and he just said, I've come up with this idea. I think we should all do it in drag. And I just said, yes, why not? So, and that's how that came up. So when we recorded it on the day, I was rehearsing in Bristol, which is quite a ways, at least 2.5 hours away from London. And I'd finished rehearsing. Roger Rees, who was a well-known actor and a good director, he was directing it. And I asked for some time off to go in. But we were just coming up to opening night, so I wasn't allowed much time off. So I think we left at about 5 or 6 in the evening after rehearsing. And my driver drove me to Battersea, to a film studio in Battersea. And I think we got there about 9 o'clock, traffic. And they put me in. I had no idea what I was going to wear. It was a better, I had no idea. I'd left it all up to them. So we did that, and we spent all night filming it, having such a laugh. And it was an exhausting thing. I think we finished at about 3:30 or 4 in the morning. And I went back to Freddie's house and I slept very briefly. And we left at 8 in the morning. So I had about an hour's sleep to go back to Bristol to start rehearsing at 10 o'clock to do my Shakespeare. Ciao, arrivederci, and thank you, and be safe, and love to you all. Heart is there.